My name is Ashia Mai. I am a freshman at the University of Delaware. I am a black woman. A black woman whose worth is often measured by her physical appearance. A black woman whose worth is measured by every curve, every shade and hue on her body. A black woman whose hips and lips are not the beauty standard. A black woman whose beauty is overshadowed. Though society continues to deem me unworthy, I know my body's a canvas. A canvas of history written by the strong black women before me. A canvas of natural beauty. A canvas in which only I can paint on. Black women's bodies have been disrespected for centuries. From being locked up in cages to having our body parts displayed in glass cases, this is the truth of how fat phobia stems from racism. This is fearing the black body. Understanding the roots of fat phobia requires delving into its often overlooked connection to racism. Social standards of beauty have historically been intertwined with power structures, fostering prejudice and stereotypes against underrepresented groups. Racial discrimination is closely linked to the stigmatization of some body types, especially those that are considered fat. Perception of normalcy and desirability have been shaped for centuries by the imposition of Eurocentric beauty standards. Diverse body types and sizes have consequently come to be vilified, especially those that are common in Black, Indigenous, and people of color communities. Beginning with high Renaissance painters like Albrecht Dürer and Peter Paul Rubens, I introduce you to the period just before enslavement reshaped the European social imaginary, where shapely white Venuses were prized and plumpness was preferred. But aesthetic preferences began to shift along the changing landscape of European cities like Antwerp and Venice, which were undergoing dramatic demographic and economic transformations with the rising slave trade. Black women became increasingly present in artist renderings, but were represented as thin, sickly servants, seen as lowly and inferior. By the 16th century, with slavery and colonization in full force in the Americas, extracted labor gave way to extracted resources, especially sugar. The reconfiguration of European diets and the mass accessibility of the white gold meant changing body shapes and sudden anxieties around fat, particularly among the male population. It is during the early Enlightenment that we first see thinness admired as a sign of male rationality. Intellectuals from Shakespeare to Descartes dismayed corpulence as indicative of dim-wittedness, with excessive consumption being primarily viewed as an obstacle to higher thought. This was bolstered by the post-Reformation context, in which self-regulation became key to cultivating morality, in which gluttony was one sin to be avoided. But it wasn't until the late 17th century that fat became a resource for racial categorization. The writings of early race scientists like George Cuvier, J.J. Verrie, and Georges-Louis Lersac drew direct ties between gluttony, stupidity, and the characteristics of Africans whose illness was attributed to their warm climate. Enlightenment-era rationalism elevated food to the moral plane of asceticism required for intellectual pursuit. Soon, a thin physique had gone from being a sign of sickliness to evidence of the moral and intellectual superiority of Europeans, supported by the writing of anthropologists and naturalists seeking to codify and biologize a racial hierarchy. These works placed particular emphasis on the bodies of Southern African women, who were depicted as grotesque, monstrous, and animalistic, while also serving a source of voyeuristic fascination in formats like Cuvier's traveling ethnographic menagerie, which featured pay-per-view displayed a robust enslaved African woman like Sarah Bartman. Sarah Bartman was born in 1789 in Xhosa Kingdom, which is now the Eastern Cape, South Africa. She was enslaved and taken to Europe, where her body was displayed for an audience. This mistreatment was allowed to happen because the white society disregarded African people, especially African women. This exploitation was part of the Human Curiosities movement of the 19th century that gave a rise to P.T. Barnum and the Carnival Freak Shows. Sarah Bartman was a member of the Kwiki people, which are the people of Southern Africa. Nobody knows her original African name. Both her parents died while she was young, so she was married off to a Kwiki man as a teenager. Sarah had an unusually large buttocks caused by a condition called steatopygia. An English doctor noticed her when he visited the Cape about 1810. He and the brother of the man to whom she was enslaved decided they could use Sarah's body to make money. Although she could not read, she signed a contract written by the doctor that required her to travel to England and Ireland as an indentured servant. However, the terms of the contract were false and Sarah stayed enslaved for life. In England, the doctor set up exhibitions of Sarah's body. Sarah was designed to appear barely clothed. Although a large number of people paid to see her, Sarah didn't make much money. When they were shown the contract with which Sarah had signed, a group of English citizens who sympathized with her situation lost their lawsuit to halt the displays. According to Sarah's testimony, she wasn't being abused either. Sarah was purchased by S. Rue, a French exhibitor in Paris, in 1814, and his exhibitions there went on. Rue profited heavily from Sarah's cruelty by allowing his guests to sexually abuse her. Scientists also studied her. 1815, Sarah died in Paris at the approximate age of 26. Her cause of death was a result of an STD due to her being sexually abused. Scientists preserved her body and displayed it in Paris to support racist theories surrounding those of African ancestry. In 1994, Nelson Mandela, the new president of South Africa, asked for France to return Sarah's body. In 2002, France agreed to return Sarah's body, and she was buried near her birthplace in Eastern Cape Province.
Try Pantene Pro-V Complete Therapy. The pro-vitamin formula does it all, giving weak, frizzy, dull hair more strength, more silkiness, and more shine. Guaranteed. The more you use it, the better it gets. Complete Therapy Conditioner. Pantene Hair. That's the beauty of health.
Victoria's Secret opens its sexiest new store at Toronto's Yorkdale Thursday, August 26th. Meet Victoria's Secret supermodel Adriana Lima at the grand opening. Only at Victoria's Secret Yorkdale.
The limited and frequently exclusive representation of beauty that characterizes modern beauty standards disproportionately marginalizes and ignores the wide range of Black women's features and aesthetics. These standards usually give priority to Eurocentric ideas, which perpetuates a narrow definition of beauty that ignores the depth of Black cultural heritage. Conventional norm-defying hair textures, skin tones, and facial features are oftentimes marginalized or underrepresented in fashion, advertising, and mainstream media. This exclusion undercuts the inherent beauty and diversity within the Black community, in addition to supporting a false narrative that suggests some characteristics are less desirable. In spite of this, there is a powerful movement that is questioning these norms, highlighting the distinctive beauty of Black women and advocating for more inclusive representation that accepts and honors all forms of beauty without prejudice or bigotry. As this video comes to an end, it is clear that racism has deep roots that originate from historical injustices and systemic biases that still influence our society today. It is evident from the stories told and facts revealed that racism still exists covertly, fostering inequality and division. But by realizing its history and effects, we have a chance to reflect as a group and take appropriate action. Recognizing these facts and actively tearing down the system to support discrimination are the first steps toward bringing about real change. It is an appeal to adopt empathy, educate ourselves, and support laws that advance justice and equality for all. Allow this video to act as a catalyst for thought-provoking discussions and constructive change as we work through the complexities of this problem. It serves as a powerful reminder that cooperation and understanding are essential for eliminating racism as a social ill from our communities.